everybody. This is Nia Pierce, editor-in-chief at SheAttack.com, and I am met with my right-handed woman and my left-handed woman. I'm going to let them go ahead and introduce themselves. Erica, you go ahead and get us started.
What's going on, everyone? I'm glad to be here. This is level three, right? So I'm excited for these topics, and thanks for listening.
Jaleesa.
What's going on, everybody? It's your girl, Jaleesa. Thanks for everybody for coming through, watching, and listening. And let's talk about some games.
Yeah, let's get started. So we've got three topics today. Just to give you guys a brief rundown, early on, we're going to be talking about the new God of War game coming to PlayStation 4, which might be sooner than we think. We're also going to talk about some Nintendo Switch rumors, because, you know, we love those. We can't just wait until the actual event. We have to have rumors up until the actual event. And then we're going to be talking about Phil Spencer and his comments about exclusivity and buying exclusive deals for the sake of your console. So before we get started on these topics, we're going to go ahead and tell you guys what we've been playing. I'll go ahead and get started. So for those of you guys who have followed me on my personal channel, I am currently on break right now, since I do work in a school district and we're on break until the 4th of January. So I've had a lot of time to play and focus and hone on my skills for Paladins. This is a game that I've been putting a lot of time into over the break. And if you guys want to know how I feel about this, go to SheAttack.com on Friday, where we'll have a big old collaborative article about our favorite games of 2016. I'll go ahead and pass it on to Erica. What have you been playing lately?
Definitely. let me just point out that Nia prefers Paladins over Overwatch.
It's better,
that's,
dude.
That's a big thing, man.
Better.
Yeah,
Paladins skill, type. Like skill base. It's not an old thing, but that's
I gotta try it. But me, I just beat Owlboy. That was an interesting game, one I was looking forward to. That was on PC. I've been playing Final Fantasy 15 when I can. That game requires a lot of time, though.
Final Fantasy 15, I can't wait to play that, for real.
Yeah, I think I have 15 hours so far. I'm like chapter 6, I think. Mm-hmm. Something like that.
I'll tell you this much. Do not get on the boat. Do what you gotta do before you get on the boat.
I am. I think, yeah, I'm doing that right now, I think. A little Battlefield, of course. That's my multiplayer right now. Those were the big three, I think, in the past couple weeks. So, yeah, I've been gaming. I mean, like you, Nia, I've been off college schedule for a bit. So I've been gaming as much as I can.
Oh my God, it's beautiful, ain't it? Oh my God.
Oh God.
So
yes.
Wonderful, dude.
It's so beautiful.
Jaleesa, what you been gaming on?
Well, me, I have been on pretty much just two games. I've been playing my Madden, of course. Because usually around this time of the year, Madden does a thing with the Ultimate Team where they have a lot of different things they got going on, like promos and stuff like that. Like, they usually do stuff for Thanksgiving, Christmas. So I usually try to hop on and play some Madden during that time. And then, like Erica said, Final Fantasy 15. Me, I think I have almost put about 55 hours in.
Damn.
I'm almost level 50, I think. I took a week off. I could be higher than that, but I started to get burned out, so I took a week off, because I'm going to try to beat it before the end of the year, because I'm on chapter 6, because the reason why I told you to not to go past chapter 6, because once you passed it, the chapters go extremely fast, and the game gets linear at the end. So if you got stuff you need to do, go ahead and do it before you get on the boat, because you probably won't be back there for a couple of chapters. I've been putting mad hours in Final Fantasy, and that's pretty much it. I know I got Last Guardian, but I haven't even put it in the game. I mean, I'll put it in the system.
Nice to see that we got a lot of diversity going on with the games that we've been playing here lately. I mean, everything from freaking Battlefield to Owlboy to Final Fantasy. I mean, dang. So before we go ahead and jump into these topics, I want to remind you guys to go and check out SheAttack.com if you want to see some dope features and editorials, some really dope opinion pieces from our staff. Don't forget that we also have a shirt shop now. We also have our Patreon and our PayPal, so that you guys can help to support our content so that we can make better original content. It can help us go to these events so that we can get more hands-on with these games and these impressions on different hardware that might be coming out and things like that. Because I'm trying to go to PAX South so I can get my hands on that Nintendo Switch, though. That's all I'm saying. So don't forget that we have these outlets, and you can do that for just a measly little dollar a month. Like, that is super easy if you feel that we make good content. So let's go ahead and talk about this God of War. So apparently God of War for the PS4 is further along than we thought. And we've got a tweet here from the director of God of War, who was responding to a fan on Twitter. So the fan on Twitter says, I have given up on God of War news. Sometimes I think the game will be only the deer hunting part. And then Corey Barlog, who is the director, went on to say, ha, no, there is a whole game here. Just finished a full playthrough with the lead. Very exciting milestone for us. So apparently this game is done. I mean, if he's played the game from start to finish, that probably means that this game is going to come out in 2017. Is anybody here looking forward to new God of War? And when do you think that we're going to be seeing this new game? Jaleesa, do you want to go ahead and take the lead on this?
Yeah. I mean, I'm a huge God of War fan. I've played all of them. And I'm excited for this. I didn't think this game was going to be as far along as it is. Because when we saw it at E3, I knew it was coming. But I just didn't know that we were going to be able to see it in the like near future, like that next year. But they have been working on God of War since 2014, I believe. I think 2013, 2014, because Ascension came out in 2013. And now I don't even think that was done by the main team, if I'm not mistaken. Mm-hmm. If it was, I can't remember. But that's the last time we've seen God of War.
Right.
So and then, you know, they came out with the remastered, but that was done by a proprietary people. It wasn't the main people doing the game. So they've had ample enough time to actually get this game going. It hit me for a loop. I didn't think we were going to see this game till 2018.
Right. So when do you think it's going to come out? Like, do you have an estimated time frame or target that you think they're shooting for?
Well, I want it to come 2017, September or November. I want it to be a holiday game, because I feel like Sony is going to need some exclusives to combat whatever Microsoft is going to do with the Scorpio next year. So if they can't win the third party battle anymore, they got to do what they did last generation and depend on all their first party exclusives.
Right.
And God of War is one exclusive that they can put in November or September that will do damage.
Right. For sure.
That's one series I feel that will be able to withstand being in the holiday.
Right.
No game out like it, to be honest with you.
Right. What do you think about this, Erica? Do you think that this game is possibly going to come out next year? Like, what do you think?
Next year is already in not even a month. It's
not
a week.
Not even a week. Days.
I know, like days.
Literally days.
It just hit me right now. Like, what? 2017. Yeah, we're here already. I want it to. Don't get me wrong. I really want this game to come out, you know, in 2017. But I'm still going to play it safe. I'm still thinking spring 2018. Doesn't God of War usually come out in spring? Usually?
Like, I'm not sure. But I know, I mean, for me, I want it to come in 2017. But that's not where I think it's going to be. But hearing this news, it kind of gives me clarification as to what they're thinking. Because it may drop in 2017.
Especially, I mean, if it does, great. I'm with you. Like, I want it to, but to be honest,
I want it to be in February, because it seems like Sony's games does better in the beginning of the year.
Right, but they have plenty coming in the next couple months. They're
good. I think that they could do
well. No, I'm not saying. I'm just saying.
Yeah.
2018. Right. Maybe February, April, or March.
Because that's what I'm thinking. March.
When Sony places their games in the first 3 months of the year, they tend to do better.
Well, yeah, because a lot of people really don't put their games out at the beginning of the year.
They starting to now.
Yeah, they need to.
It's
a new holiday.
It is. It really is.
But that's why I was saying, you know, maybe spring, like March. That I think that's a good month. But I mean, we do have, they're saying they play through the game, but like you said earlier, it needs to be optimized still. There's probably tons of bugs. There's probably other things they need to polish. I mean, I don't know how long that's gonna take, so I'm just playing it safe. I still say 2018. That's me.
For me, I wouldn't be mad at them if it comes in 2017. Like, if they show a release date at E3 and be like 2017 November, I'll be like, okay, cool, I see it. Because all they have to do is optimize it and polish it, and knowing Sony Santa Monica's caliber of a studio, I'll give them a good year. Because you got to realize, like I said, this game has been in development since 2014, because they've talked about God of War, because people was wondering when it was going to come back. And a friend of mine named, I think you met him, Erica, my boy Kevin, he's the guy who actually, he went to PSX and went to a panel, and one of the God of War people was there, and he asked him a question, and it made news when he said that God of War was in development.
Yeah.
So we've been knowing about God of War for a minute.
All right, so let's go ahead and move on. Let's go ahead and move on to the next topic. So next topic is going to be Nintendo Switch rumors, and they come by way of Laura K. Dell from Let's Play Video Games, and she has been a very poignant, a very important leaker for the Nintendo Switch rumors, because she's now, like, I think she's now probably superseded Emily Rogers, who's also kind of accurate and then sometimes not so much on Nintendo rumors, but apparently somebody's leaking rumors to her like crazy, because she's just been leaking everything, and Nintendo UK actually blacklisted her, so now she's just letting it all out because she's been telling too much truth. But so here are a couple of rumors. Apparently Retro Studios is working on a new game and not the new Metroid. Apparently the Nintendo January event is going to be very beefy with information, and is going to tell all aspects of the console and its games, and is going to be approximately 30 to 60 minutes in length. Rumors about the console itself is it's supposedly supposed to launch around March 17th in the UK, with all regions receiving the console within the same week. The console is supposed to be region free. It's supposed to launch at £200 UK, with an SKU that is at or under $300. I don't know if that's what currency that is. I don't know if that's USD, Canadian, whatever, pounds or whatever. It's supposed to have at least 32 gigs of internal memory in the entry level model. Apparently it's supposed to have an achievement system implemented, but we don't know if it's a part of My Nintendo, which is their rewards program, or if it's a separate setup that's dedicated to the system itself. The maximum battery life is supposed to be 3 hours. It's supposed to have Bluetooth support. The touchscreen will be touch. Miiverse is supposed to be returning via the share button that has been revealed in the patents on the Nintendo Switch device itself, where you can upload screenshots and video recordings and to other outlets other than Miiverse. The controllers are supposed to have analog triggers. There's supposed to be an Ethernet port built in. There's an Ethernet port built in on the dev kits, but on the public demo units there is not an Ethernet port. But it's supposed to support 5 gigahertz of Wi-Fi. That's like the highest Wi-Fi that's out right now. And it's supposed to have gyro support. 128 gig micro SDs are supposedly viable for external storage options. So it's good that they're supporting micro SDs. That's something I was kind of concerned about. As far as the rumored launch games and beyond, there's supposed to be 3 third-party exclusive games. One of them is supposedly that Mario Rabbids RPG. Virtual console is not gonna be as beefy out the gate. Like, it might have a couple of titles, but not as many as a lot of people might want. As far as Mario Kart 8, it's supposed to get an extensive port for the Nintendo Switch. The Super Smash Bros. Port is supposed to have minimal additions, so not as beefy as the Mario Kart 8 port. There's supposedly a CGI teaser for Beyond Good and Evil 2 in the works, and it will be less than a minute long. There is no word on whether or not this reveal trailer will be ready for the January event. Monolith Soft, the people behind Xenoblade and Xenoblade Chronicles X, is working on something totally new with a combat style that is similar to what we see currently in the Xenoblade franchise. And again, Retro Studios is working on something completely new, and we know that it's not Metroid, so I don't really know what they're working on, but it's something big, because they've been hiring out the ass. Like, they've been hiring for like 2 to 3 years, and like, they're still hiring up to like even like a couple of days ago. So I don't know what they're doing. Anyway, does anybody have any opinions on this before we move on to the next topic? That's a lot of information.
Yeah, a lot to digest.
Rip, huh? No, old girl just been letting it rip, ain't she?
She's been letting it rip. She like, okay, y'all gonna blacklist me? Well, I'm gonna spill some more truth on y'all.
Let me tell you.
That date, I will say that.
Yeah, the date, I like the March release date. The region free thing is good. That's something that's plagued them for a while. Yeah. It's kind of been a problem, right? So the battery life, not so hot on that, but I mean, it is what it is. The achievement thing. I wanted to touch on that. I hope it's a separate setup. I hope it's something along the lines of like Xbox and PS4, mm-hmm. you know, with the trophies and something that's just so iconic and part of Nintendo that it just grows from there. You know what I mean?
Yeah, but I mean, if they do it a part of My Nintendo, it could still have that though, because My Nintendo is their new rewards program. I don't know if you ever partook in Club Nintendo, but it's basically before digital stuff, where you could earn points just for playing games. Right now, it's kind of bare bones because they're still kind of started up and everything. But it works with like their mobile stuff. So like, say if you like log on to Miitomo and Super Mario Run, you get points to your My Nintendo, and it shows up as like achievements, and you get discounts on games and stuff like that. So if they found, like, if I could play games to get achievements to get like to get that money off for games,
yeah,
I'm here for that. I'm here for that. Hopefully, it's something like that. Right. I would like to see that personally.
That sounds cool to me. Yeah. So I mean, that sounds good. A lot of this sounds good to me. Yeah. But just I think just like the battery life and a couple other things are a little disappointing. But I mean, these are rumors. We don't know what's gonna happen. I just can't wait for this event. I can't wait for it.
They have to knock it out the park. Like they have to.
Yeah, they really do.
But she said that it's supposed to have a lot of information similar to some of their better directs. So we'll see.
And like you said, very beefy. So when I think of beefy, I'm thinking a lot of freaking info. They better come with it.
If they show Monolith Soft Game and they show Retro Studios Game, like to me, like they won the reveal. Like look, just show me what they're working on.
Let me ask you a question. What do you think they are working on? If it's not Metroid, what in the world is it?
I think they're working on something completely new. I think they're finally giving Retro the liberty they deserve. Retro pretty much transformed Metroid. Like, Metroid has always been like a dope franchise, but what they did with Metroid Prime was like, like they completely just reimagine that franchise and made it even more epic. So I think they deserve to be able to work on something new, and I think that they will be working on something new. But let's go ahead and move on from that, and let's talk about Phil Spencer for a little bit. So he said some really controversial things on Twitter. A lot of people called him out on, and I'm gonna go down some of these tweets real quick and kind of give you guys a brief rundown. So someone replied to Phil on Twitter saying, "Phil, bring Rise back to Xbox." And then he replied to that person saying, "Console gaming needs growth. Doesn't happen via existing game / markets. Old keeps core happy. New can grow the market. Balance is key." And then he said something else in response to someone, "Yes, this is a balance. Redoing launch portfolio will keep some happy, but we should all want all gaming to be growing." And then he mentioned EA Access, Fallout mods, game preview, X-Play, I think move gaming forward. Our first party IP should do the same. It's why I love what the people are doing with Halo 5 Forge right now. Amazing creativity. And then he went on to say what a lot of people felt were really controversial of him to say, "Paying marketing funds so another console's base can't play a piece of content doesn't feel like growth." And then people called him out on it, called him a hypocrite, and then he came with this as a defense for his comments. He said that people are getting worked up on this. "Never said Xbox has never done this. Not calling out others. Just not a practice I like. That's it." So I'm gonna give it over to Erica first, because you did mention that you had some thoughts about this. So what do you feel about Phil Spencer's thoughts? Why do you feel it was so controversial? And what do you think is like the overarching factor of why he said what he said?
The way I feel about Phil Spencer is like, his words hold so much weight. Like, whether it's with the haters or the fanboys or just any fan, whatever he says, like, people twist it, they're gonna turn it into more controversy, and then he has to clarify himself. Like, I almost feel like he should just stay off Twitter.
Yeah.
Unless it's just like advertising or basic like professional tweets, because this happens a lot. Like this is the first time, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I kind of feel like, I don't want to say bad for him, but I kind of feel he put himself out there. And my initial reaction was, you're a freaking hypocrite, because I thought about the past. I thought about all the exclusive deals that Xbox had. Even if he wasn't in control, he worked for them. He was a huge part of the Xbox brand and the gaming division. And I just felt like, does he not remember what they used to do? And then I started thinking, okay, if it was reversed and Xbox was still getting these deals, would he say this? I don't think he would say this. It kind of felt like damage control.
Right.
I started thinking like, he's only saying this because they don't have these deals anymore. They don't have the Call of Duty deal. They don't have other deals. So I just kind of took it as like, he's just playing it cool. He's kind of saying what the gamers want to hear. And then the fanboys ran with it, that he was owning everybody and doing all this, you know, there's like a more to it with just a lot of fans. But that was kind of my initial reaction. But again, with his words holding so much weight and people twisting his words and all of that, it kind of goes like both ways. Like I'm kind of right down the middle now. But that was just kind of my initial reaction.
Jaleesa, what do you feel about Phil Spencer's thoughts on this?
Way Erica feels, man. At first, I was like, yo, I'll say this. I love the fact that Phil Spencer does talk to the fans on Twitter. He talks a lot more than maybe like the Yoshidas of the world. He'll talk to regular fans. He'll, you know what I'm saying, just have conversations with them and stuff like that. And I think that's awesome. Him, Larry Herbert do it sometimes. Forgot the other guy's name that's on Twitter. I forgot his name. But I know he does it a lot too. But sometimes he don't need to say stuff because he just made himself look like a hypocrite. And even though, like Erica said before, he wasn't one of the main guys or such and such, but he was in the division when they were doing all this stuff. He may not agree with it, but did he object to it when they were winning? If they were winning now, would he feel the same way? Or would he even tell anybody he felt the same way? I don't think he would.
Mm-hmm.
So I felt like he should have kept that to himself because it made him sound like a hypocrite. Because if all of us gamers, me, you, and Erica, PS3, 360, we were a part of that era. We were all a part of that. We was a huge part of that era, and we remember the Call of Duty stuff. And
oh yeah, that was a huge with Xbox back
yeah
then.
All especially of us remember for PlayStation owners having to wait, was it like 3 or 4 months before we even touched DLC? So for him to come out and say that, most of the fanboys already were triggered as is. They just waiting on him to mess up. So he gave him ammo. Like that's pure. Not, and to be honest, not even the fanboys, even gamers like us who are like, yo, like, do you got amnesia? Like, come on. Like most casual fans, they don't follow stuff like that. But hardcore fans, like, we remember having to wait some odd months just to get a piece of content because Microsoft had it first.
Yeah, that's true. That's very true. That was definitely a practice they didn't shy away from in the 360.
They didn't, because they were winning. they didn't
but when you think about it though, that's how they won though. I think that was strategic. Right. Like it was strategically placed because that's how, because I mean when they first came into the market, they even made it well known. We came into the market to take away some of Sony's market share. And that was their way of dominating. They're like, hey, we might not be able to compete pound for pound because PlayStation was here before us, but guess what? We're gonna get them deals though. And that's exactly what they did. But I'm of a different mind. When I first heard about this, you know, of course, you know, a lot of people retweet these fanboys on Twitter and I don't really pay attention to that stuff. I think it's stupid. I guess because like as a Nintendo fan, I'm kind of like, okay, whatever, y'all have at it. We'll stay over here and be irrelevant. But so like when I first heard about it, I was like, dang, Phil Spencer, he done said some crazy stuff. So I went on Twitter and I was like, this is what people are amped about? Like, I didn't really see it as that big of a deal because I put it like this. I'm not really a Microsoft head. Like, I really just got into the Xbox brand this generation. I didn't have an OG Xbox. When it came down to the Xbox 360, I didn't really play it because it wasn't mine. It was my mom who she was dating at the time. He had one in the house and I played like Halo 4 on it and like a Lego game. And like that was pretty much my extent with the Xbox 360. And then for the Xbox One, I didn't really care about it either. And then they announced Sunset Overdrive and I was like, dang, I gotta play that. So whenever it became affordable for me, I went out and bought my very first Xbox. So just understand that if you're listening to this is out of pure ignorance of me, right? I don't know nothing about Xbox. So when I first read this, I was like, I don't see how people are making a big deal, because just based on the way that Don Matrick ran Xbox, like, he was just super, like, green. You know what I mean? Like, he was skeevy, bro. I mean, he ran it like a business, but he was grimy too, though. But and then, like, when he left and he went to Zynga, and Phil Spencer stepped in place, I was skeptical of him, because I always kind of saw the Xbox brand, it was like, they're like this corporate evil, right? But then when Phil Spencer came in and he started trying to prove himself, I was like, yo, this dude seems like he's actually a gamer. So I think that Phil Spencer is in a very awkward situation, because I think that when he says things like this, he's speaking about it from the position of a gamer. But he's also a businessman at the same time, so he's really got to be careful with his words, because like you guys said before, people will take your words and twist them like crazy. And like, you know, he even mentioned in his tweet, like, not saying that we never did it, not calling anybody out, but it's not a practice that I like. And it's how many businessmen out there, you know, get outvoted or get outshined by somebody else's idea, even though they don't agree with it, because the consensus is that this is a good idea. And I'm sure that happens in Xbox as well. And even though Phil Spencer's the head of Xbox, there was a lot of things going on before his time as the head of Xbox that were probably still in place that won't be weaned out until he really gets his foot in the door and the Scorpio is out and that's his baby. You know what I mean? So if that's the case, which I'm assuming it is, I don't really see why people are making a big deal out of it. But I understand why at the same time, because I mean, this is something that Xbox did for the whole 360 generation. But maybe it's because I have this affinity for rooting for the underdog. I don't know. So like, if somebody, I am a Nintendo fan. So it's like, when I see some people beating up on somebody, I'm gonna see what's really going on, and then I'm gonna give my opinion on it. I'm not gonna jump on a bandwagon like, oh, you suck. How dare you? You know what I mean? Yeah. Like, I'm gonna see what's going on first, and then I'll chime in.
So, but see, Nick, it's the thing, though. The thing about it was the whole, like you said, it happened the whole generation. And I think what bothered people more was that the fanboys were agreeing with it. And I'm looking at these people like, yo, you.
But they're fanboys. They're going to say whatever to build up their brand. They don't matter.
No. This is the thing. I'm saying that when he said what he said, all of them agreed with him. And I'm listening to him like, at the beginning of this generation, before Xbox started losing like they were losing, you were with all of this. You were happy they were doing it.
Because they're fanboys.
But now all of a sudden it's bad. And now
they're winning. Because they're fanboys.
Because they were winning too.
Very true. But I'm just saying, like, it was just so hypocritical. And I'm like, yo. And then Phil started doing what he was doing on the back burner and saying stuff to certain people. And it was kind of stroking his ego a little bit. And I'm like, come on, y'all. Like,
He was playing it cool.
They're fanboys, dude. Like, you will never understand fanboys unless you're a fanboy. Like, that's the way I look at it. Maybe it's because I look at it different, because I don't really pay attention to fanboys because they're stupid. Like, why would I listen to you? But like, I think Phil Spencer wholeheartedly believes what he says. And now that he's the head of Xbox, he can say this stuff because he's the top dude. You know what I mean? So
but
it's like,
if they were winning,
of course that he wouldn't have said it, because that would make his brand. How can I say this? If they were winning, he wouldn't say it, because that would counteract the partnerships and the deals that he has with other people. That would mess up those partnerships. You can't openly come out and say, I think exclusive deals are trash, when you have a person like Activision who's your partner. You can't do that.
But you know what I mean? Did he think this way during last gen?
I believe he probably did.
Yeah,
because
I mean,
like,
I,
even
I like
when
he didn't say nothing,
it's not like hate towards Phil, because I love Phil. I love what he's done with Xbox, because he's turned it around, because Xbox could be doing worse.
I don't know. I think people think too hard about the console war thing. Like,
yeah,
that's what I think. I think people are all like, who's winning, and people look at it like, I believe that Phil Spencer is actually a person who legitimately enjoys games. I think that to him, the Xbox brand is more than just a business. I think that he legitimately cares what is on it, you know, how people experience those types of experiences. You know what I mean? So, like,
True. That's
just my opinion of Phil Spencer based on the presentation that he showed since he's been in office. And even though Xbox is struggling right now with exclusives, like, as soon as Phil Spencer came until like the head of Xbox, he made it a point to make sure that every presentation that they had has been focused on games, whether they've been exclusives, whether they've been third party, because he wants people to know that, yeah, the Xbox brand messed up. They focused on it being like a set-top box more than anything, but I'm trying to make this thing a console first. And to me, that's always the impression that he's given to me. So that's why I believe, he probably believes it, but probably didn't say it, because that's gonna mess up his partnerships. Like, Jaleesa, if you gave me a candy cane, right? Say you gave me a candy cane, and then I go on Twitter and talk about how much I hate candy canes. That's gonna make you wanna take your candy canes back. That's what I'm saying. And that's why I feel like Phil Spencer is a gamer at heart, but he's also in this tight position where he also is representing a company. And I think that a lot of people, it's his fault too for putting himself out there. I give it to them, you know, for people who say that. It's his fault. He put himself out there, but I think that it's just a very conflicting space where you're trying to be a gamer and you're also trying to run a business and you're also trying to keep in touch with your community. Very tough. He might need to scale it back.
And they were just waiting. They be waiting on him to say something. And if he say something, the wrong thing, they just blow it up out of proportion.
I think so too. And I think that people make it a big deal because of the whole console war. Like, this imaginary console war people think exists. But that's just me.
I just hate
they need ammo. Yeah, they need
I
it.
Just hate to think about
that. Who cares? They're fanboys. Of course they're stupid.
I just remember waiting on Call of Duty DLC for like 3 months. And so, now I'm a little salty.
So you salty. And there's nothing wrong with that. You have every right to feel how you feel. But as an outsider looking in, that's just how I look at it.
And that's when Call of Duty was at its prime. That's when it mattered. Now it not so much. Well, for back then that was a system seller. That was a big deal.
Yeah. When it mattered, it really mattered.
That's true. That's a big time. Call of Duty, man. That's a topic for a whole other Boss Lair.
So, hey, man, it is what it is.
Yeah. So I think that's gonna go ahead and conclude our topics, man. That was a good discussion. That was dope. We gotta have some more bangers like that. So,
Spencer, keep tweeting.
Oh my God, yes. So thank you guys so much for watching, Boss Lair. Don't forget about our shirt shop at shop.spreadshirt.com/SheAttack. We also have our Patreon. $1 a month would help us tremendously, you guys. And what I'm gonna start doing is I'm gonna start putting our Patreons on our actual videos on Boss Lair, a list of everybody who supports us so that you guys can get that love and respect that you deserve. And if you just wanna make a one-time donation to our PayPal, that helps us greatly. You know what I'm saying? We're trying to get to these PAXs, we're trying to get to these conventions, we're trying to get to E3. And that will help us a lot with airfare and hotels and getting better equipment. Because everybody ain't got MLG cameras like my girl Jaleesa over here. So that would help us a lot, you guys. But it's been Nia Pierce, editor-in-chief at SheAttack.com. And I'm going to go ahead and let my ladies give their outros. Jaleesa.
All right, people. Thanks for coming to level 3 of the podcast. I really enjoyed it. I love doing these things and talking about games and stuff like that with my girls. Since we don't really talk to each other like we should. I miss you. I mean, if you would check your Twitter. Hey, man.
We'd be chopping it up on Twitter.
Don't put me on blast. But yeah, thanks for everybody for coming through. We'll see y'all in 2017. Can't wait to start talking about some of the new games that's coming out next year. January is going to be a lot of games dropping February, so we're going to have a lot of stuff to talk about.
Oh yeah, and we have our favorite games of 2016 coming. You guys will be able to see what our most anticipated games are for 2017 as well in that collaborative article. Don't forget to check it out. It should be up on Friday, no later than Friday, so make sure you stay locked on SheAttack.com. If you also want to check out where I got those rumors, I posted the rumors on SheAttack.com, so that's available to you guys as well. Sorry, Jaleesa. I had to get that in.
I'm done.
All right, Erica, go ahead and give your outro.
All right, so speaking of games, PSA, please buy Neo. That's my predicted game of the year for 2017. Nice. I'm so hyped about this game. Buy it. It's gonna be great. But yeah, it was a good time. Thank you guys so much for listening. I had fun. Stay tuned for our next show. And I'm out.
So that concludes our show. Talk to you later, guys. Peace.